Good morning. It's good to be back in the house of the Lord, isn't it? Amen. Hallelujah. Let's all stand as we start our service for today. It's a wonderful season, isn't it? Hallelujah. Let's all go to prayer. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this day. We're thankful for all your many blessings that you bestow upon us. We pray that you and the Holy Spirit will meet with us today, lift our spirits up, and help us to praise our Christ and our Savior. And we give you all the praise in your holy name. Amen. Amen. While shepherds watch their watching, or silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds feared and trembled when low above the earth rang out the angel chorus that hailed our Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Down in a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born and brought us God's salvation that blessed Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Yes, go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Hallelujah. Says, go tell about our Christ, our Savior. Hallelujah. Everywhere. Hallelujah. It should be on the end of our tongue all the time. Hallelujah.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. Heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let saints their songs implore. What fields and flood, rocks, hills and plain, repeat the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy. Repeat, repeat the sounding joy. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness. Wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love. You know, that last verse says, he rules the world with truth and grace. It'd be really good if the leaders of our world would take that to heart, wouldn't it? Hallelujah. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness. Wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders and wonders of his love. Hallelujah.
With us. Doesn't that bring joy to your heart? Amen. He loves to be with his people. He loves to be with us. Praise God. And Lord, we love you so much. We bless you. We worship you, Heavenly Father. We bless you, Jesus, Son of God. We love you, Holy Spirit. God, you are wonderful. You are amazing. Lord, we love you so much, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, let's sing that song again. And, you know, as the worship team sings, you just love on your Savior. Love on your Father in heaven. Hallelujah. He loves you.
Emmanuel. Emmanuel. His name is called.
Amen. Oh, Lord, are so welcome among us. We love you, Lord. Lord, you are the greatest gift. Lord, you are, Lord, more precious to us than anything in this life, Lord. Jesus, it's you. It's you, Lord. Precious Lord. Precious Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. And thank you, Heavenly Father, for loving us, for answering prayer. Thank you, Lord, for Jennifer being here this morning, Lord. Wonderful praise report, God. Thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for Fred and Faye being here, Lord, this morning. Thank you for your help and your grace. Thank you, Jesus, that you hear our prayers. Hallelujah. And Lord, we lift up Ron Farmer before you, God, and you know his health issues. And God, we pray that you'll reach down, that you'll touch and heal him. Lord, for Chesney, the young girl with brain cancer, and she's had a stroke. And Lord, we pray your healing grace upon her, Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, for Ginny, Lord, and she's having back pain. And Lord, we pray that, God, that you'll reach down and touch her. God, that you'll relieve her of this pain. Lord, for Aira, this two-year-old, Lord, who's had a heart transplant. And Lord, she needs a touch from you. Jesus, you are the creator. You are the author of life. And we pray that you'll reach down with your healing hand, Lord, and touch her. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we lift up Jeff Orman before you. And God, you know his needs and his body, Lord. Touch him in his heart, Lord. Bless him. Bless him with health and life. Lord, Fred is going to be having another procedure done. And Lord, we pray that, God, you'd be with him in a miraculous way, Lord. We ask, God, that you would give him grace not to even feel anything, Father, when they do this procedure. And Lord, we lift up Olivia, this young girl who's been dealing with cancer. And God, thank you for good reports, Lord. And we pray your blessing on this girl. Lord, we pray, God, that, Lord, as she has this last procedure done, removing of that port, God, Lord, just let it be such peace and joy for the family. God, what a celebration for Christmas, God. You've given life to their daughter. Thank you, Lord. God, we pray for, Joe Kim on hospice. Fred, this is Fred Hetzel's sister. And Lord, we pray, God, that, Lord, that your peace that passes all understanding would be upon her. We pray, Lord, that she would know, God, that she could rest in your care. Lord, that she can have her faith in you and trust. And Lord, look forward to eternal life. And Lord, being with Fred, God, as she rests in you as her Savior. Lord, give her grace, we pray. And Father, we lift up Christopher and other unspoken requests here today, Lord. God, we put every need into your hands. And Lord, we thank you for William and Judy, Lord. They're at home, but God, you're with them and others who weren't able to make it. Lord, we pray your grace, your encouragement, Lord, your touch upon them today. And Lord, your word says, even in laughter, the heart may ache. God, we can put on a front real good for people, but Lord, you know what's happening in our hearts. And Lord, those who are sad, those who are grieving, Lord, those who are discouraged, Lord, whatever's happened in their lives, God, we pray, God, that you would encourage, that you would lift up, that you would comfort. Jesus, that you would touch each and every one in their heart of hearts. Lord, bring hope today. God, that's what you created church service for, Lord, for us to be encouraged. Lord, encourage your people today. Minister and meet every need. God, and we thank you for that. And Lord, we pray that, God, as we gather, Lord, for these Christmas dinners and whatnot with family and friends, Lord, we pray that you'd be with us in a very personal way. And family members who don't know you, God, we ask that you would open their hearts, God, that they would realize, Jesus, that how much they need you. And how much, God, you are showing your love for them in sending your son. Father, in Jesus' name we pray. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers this morning. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Well, let's continue to worship the Lord in our giving this morning. And there's an offering plate here, there. Or you could give online. And amen. Amen. Lord, thank you. Thank you, God, that we can rest in you for our every physical need on this earth. Lord, you told us not to worry, Jesus, but to seek you first and your kingdom and all these things, God, the necessities of life would be added to us. And so, Lord, we give this morning saying thank you. Lord, bless your people as they give today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, come, let us adore. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. For he alone is worthy. For he alone is worthy. For he alone is worthy, Christ the Lord. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord.
Praise the Lord. That was a wonderful song. Thank you. Thank you, worship team. Praise the Lord. Aren't you glad Jesus is your Lord? Praise God. Well, don't you enjoy buying gifts for others? Now, Robert's kind of making a funny look on his face. Sometimes the shopping experience is a little stressful, but we like giving gifts to others, don't we? Whether it's a store-bought gift or something homemade or a financial gift, and because we love people, we care about them, and you want to bless that person, and it's you want to see the look on their face, you know, when they open that gift. And even the shopping part can be fun because you're trying to find the just the right gift for that person, right? And Jesus, he said it's more blessed to give than to receive. That's what the Lord said. And you know, he said that because God was speaking from experience. God loves to give gifts. Praise the Lord. And in fact, in James chapter 1, verse 16, the Bible says, "Don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows." In other words, God is steady. He's always the same, and all his gifts are always good. Praise the Lord. And the Bible says this in Psalm 103:5, "Who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles." God loves to give his children good gifts. Praise the Lord. And so, you know, if you have a view of God that he's a Scrooge, right? You got to try to get something out of him. It's hard to get something out of God because he just doesn't want to give. He's a Scrooge. Well, you know what? You got the wrong view of God. And I pray this morning this message will change your mind, because God loves to give good gifts. Let's pray. Lord, you are a giver. You are a giver. You love to give, Lord. That's your heart. That's your personality. Lord, you love to give good gifts to people, Lord. And Lord, I pray this morning that you would help each and every one of us to see, God, how much we are loved by you, and that, God, you're still giving us good gifts today. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, for your help this morning. Amen. Well, you know, as I studied the word given in the Bible, it became evident that everything is a gift from God. Everything is a gift. God gave us life. He gave us a wonderful world of beauty and sounds and tastes and provision, and they're all gifts. Everything is a gift. He gave Eve to Adam, and he gave Adam to Eve. He gave them children. He gives us graces. He gave us his Son. He gave us himself. He gave us his Spirit. He gives us spiritual gifts and talents. He's given us his Word. Everything is a gift. It's a gift from God. And I frequented this thought a few times, I know, from the pulpit, but I keep going back to it. And I felt this morning God, you know, telling me to preach on gifts, his gifts. And when a couple is expecting a child, they go through great lengths to make sure everything's ready, right? They prepare the baby's room and everything for this little bundle to arrive. They make sure they have a safe crib to sleep in, blankets to keep them warm, a mobile to hang above them to get their little mind to wondering, and stuffed animals to play with, bright primary colors to stimulate their minds, a rocking chair right in the room to bring them comfort, a changing table, and a baby bath to care for their needs. And when Stacy and I, we were expecting Olivia, well, we even got a baby wipe warmer because we saw the reaction of babies with those cold wet wipes on their behind. So we didn't want to do that to our kids, so we had this little warmer, and sometimes it kind of bake them a little bit and it turned colors, you know, but it'd be warm. Well, the Bible is clear that the whole world, the universe, was made for us. It was made for us. Praise the Lord. You know, evolution is such a lie. It's such a lie. It's so cold and impersonal, and it's just a roll of the dice, which is just crazy. But God created everything for us. Praise the Lord. When God decided to have children, people made in His image, He first went to work in preparing a wonderful place for His children to live. And that is why mankind was created on the sixth day, because He got the baby's room ready, and he created Adam and Eve. Praise the Lord. And so everything in the universe was created with you and I in mind, both the salt water and the fresh water for us to enjoy and to live by. He created lush grass to walk on, trees that would give us shade and be fun to climb, right? Trees that would give us fruit and wood for us to be able to create all kinds of things. He gave us, we can, from that wood, we can create homes and tools, furniture, games, toys. We can create so much from wood. And He gave us all kinds of plants that would produce food above and food underground, and also for spices to flavor our dishes. And aren't you glad that God made eating enjoyable, right? And we can take all kinds of ingredients. Really, cooking is a form of chemistry. You know, you're taking all these things, and the first person that either ate a cocoa bean or a coffee bean, it was bitter. But then you add some sugar to it, and it tastes a whole lot better. And it's all chemistry. But God created those things, and He created plants for medicine, for healing for our bodies. Even we can make clothes out of plants, right? Cotton. Kind of forget about that one, but praise the Lord. And people around the world, they take gourds, you know, because you think of a gourd, and a lot of gourds, you can't eat gourds. You know, you get sick. Some of them will kill you. But you know what? Gourds, by people around the world, they use them to make bowls and ladles and all kinds of things. And so God knew what He was doing. We were going to need that. And we even make paper out of plants. He created all kinds of creatures to fill us with wonder and to enjoy as pets. Everything a gift from the Lord. You know, God could have made Adam and Eve with just a bunch of plants, right? And they could have lived, but it wouldn't have been as much fun, right? Without the animals. And so God gave us animals, and praise the Lord, a lot of them even taste good, right? And we also make clothes out of them and birds to enjoy looking at. My parents, they love bird watching, and they had a feeder out front and binoculars and a bird book, and I got their pure little binoculars and bird book, and birds are just, I believe birds are special to the Lord. I just really do, reading in the Word. And He gave us a beautiful night sky with the stars and constellations and planets. Right after creation, we can read about people taking all those gifts that God has given them, and we can read that people made musical instruments and they made tools and using the resources that God gave us in the earth. And so when the Lord created each of us out of love, He also gave each of us gifts. He gave us gifts and talents. He did. If you can decorate, well, that's a gift. Usually ladies have that gift. You walk into a guy's home, you can tell it's a guy lives there. You walk into a lady's home, or husband and wife, you know that there's a female that lives in that house. And It's a gift. There's people are gifted with math. You know, how many could say, oh, I'm horrible at math? Well, then other people, it just comes real easy. My brother-in-law, he was gifted in that, and his kids went on to be engineers, and his relative was a NASA engineer that built the moon rover. It's just a gift that God has given them, and we, you know people that have gifts of music and singing, but God gave us these gifts to enjoy them. They're gifts from the Lord, gifts from God. And you know what? So don't look at other gifts that other people have and complain. God doesn't love anyone any less. He loves you, and he's given you gifts. Sometimes you just can't see it. And you know, the Bible says that a spouse is a gift. Children are a gift. The Lord has given us many gifts. He's blessed us. And the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. You know, in 4 BC, another child was born into the world. But this particular child was different and more than any other child, because this baby boy that was born to two Jewish parents was God giving his son a gift to the world. And like most proud fathers, God the Father was bursting with joy to share the wonderful news of the birth of his son on this earth. And in the Gospel of Luke, we read, and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. And the Bible says, suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests. Praise the Lord. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. That little baby born in Bethlehem was God's gift. God's gift to you and I, his gift to the world. The Bible says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Praise the Lord. You know, God in love calls us his sons and daughters, and through Christ we are, but there's only one, the Son of God. That's Jesus. God didn't hold back any expense in order to give you and I the gift of life. It was the cost of his only son suffering horribly for us and dying a bloody death. The Bible says it wasn't with perishable things that he redeemed us. God didn't use money. The Bible says, for you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. You know, I was thinking on this, that when God was creating the universe, when he was creating this earth, the Bible says he created everything out of nothing, right? the gifts that he was giving us, he was just speaking into existence, right? Jay, you're going to love those dogs, right? Beverly Online, you're going to love that bird, right? He's just speaking these different things into existence. And I believe some of the gifts he gave us were from himself, imparting, you know, gifts of creativity and, you know, intelligence, and some of more than others. But giving these gifts, sending them from himself. But, you know, the gift of Jesus wasn't created. He wasn't spoken to existence. He's God. He is the creator. God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he came into the world giving himself. And the Bible says this: he was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Isn't that amazing? Way back in the garden, God's first two kids hadn't been around very long, and they end up sinning. They end up cutting themselves off in their spiritual life and relationship with God. And all the way back in the beginning, God says, I'm gonna give them one more gift. They're gonna get the gift of my son. They're gonna get the gift of my son. Isn't that wonderful? He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times. For whose sake? For our sake. For us. There's a word in the NIV Bible that's only used once, and it's used pertaining to God giving his son. You know, anyone want to take a jab at what this one word is? In the entire NIV Bible, the word's only used once, and it has to do with God giving his son. Indescribable. You only find that once. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Paul wrote that. God's gift is just indescribable. We can never adequately describe the gift God has given to each of us in his only son, Jesus. Indescribable. The Bible says this, Romans chapter 5, verse 15. But the gift, okay, the gift of God's son, is not like the trespass, okay, talking about the sin, the original sin that Adam and Eve committed. For if the many died by the trespass of the one man, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many? Nor can the gift of God be compared with the result of the one man's sin. The judgment followed one sin and brought condemnation, but the gift followed many trespasses and brought justification. For if by the trespass of the one man death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? An indescribable gift. God gave Jesus after the world had already committed so many sins. And the gift that God gave was going to take care of not only the sins all the way since Adam and Eve, but past, but all the way through, right, 2023, our sins, and all the way to the last person who will ever be born and live on this earth. Jesus took care of it all. It's an awesome gift. And you know what? Look what the Bible says, the gift of righteousness. The gift of righteousness. Because see, nobody can get into heaven without being perfectly righteous. Anybody here perfectly righteous? You never had to say you're sorry all your life? You never had to say, oh, I shouldn't have done that, or I shouldn't have said that? Nobody here ever had their conscience, you know, prick them and ooh. No, but the gift of righteousness, a gift. And look what the Bible says in the next chapter of Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's in God's Christmas gift for us. It's righteousness and eternal life. Isn't that awesome? And the Bible says in Ephesians 2 and verse 8, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this not from yourselves. It is the gift of God. Praise the Lord. You can't buy salvation. You can't buy righteousness. You can't earn your way to heaven. It's a gift. Praise the Lord. Not by works, so that no one can boast. Praise the Lord. Righteousness, eternal life, salvation are all gifts from our Heavenly Father, bought and paid for by God with the blood of His Son, Jesus. Isn't that amazing? God didn't hold back any expense in order to give us the gift we needed. All of us, when we're Christmas shopping, I think most of, wouldn't it be awesome if you were like a millionaire? Wouldn't that be great? And what I'm getting at is this, if we were millionaires, we wouldn't have to count the cost when giving Christmas gifts, right? We'd say, well, I know, you know, my son or daughter, maybe somebody at church or so-and-so, you know, they need a new car. I'm going to get them a new car for Christmas, put a bow on it. Merry Christmas, right? Wouldn't that be awesome to be a billionaire? You know, and I say, God, I could handle money. I'm generous. Oh, you could pour it on. But usually, though, we have to count the cost, right? We're budgeting, okay, I got this much I can spend on Christmas gifts, and so family's going to get this much, friend's going to get this much, and I'm going to get this much. And depending on who you are, it's either this much or this much compared to your friends and family. But we have to count. But you know what? God, He didn't hold anything back. It was at the cost of His only Son, suffering a horrible, bloody death, that He could give us the gift of salvation, the gift of eternal life, the gift of righteousness. There's a story I heard a long time ago, and it came to mind in preparing this message, and I believe the Lord wanted me to share this, the story of John Griffith. And John Griffith was in his early 20s. He was newly married and full of optimism. He was married. They had a little baby. He was living the American dream. But then the stock market crash came in 1929. And it shattered not only the American economy, but John's dreams. And so brokenhearted, he packed up his few possessions, hopped in his Model A Ford with his little family, and he moved from Oklahoma to the Mississippi River, where he got a job working a railroad drawbridge. And day after day, John would sit at his controls and open it up for the boats and barges to go by, and he would look kind of wistfully at the barges and boats going by and wondering where they're going. And see, he kind of felt like his life was going nowhere. But it wasn't until 1937 that a new dream began to form in John's heart. His young son, Greg, was now 8 years old. And he thought, you know, I'm going to bring Greg to work with me. And I could see us, little Greg, growing up together and us working together. And that kind of put a dream in his heart. And so the first day, they grabbed their packed lunches and headed off towards the huge bridge that John worked at. And Greg, his little son, looked wide-eyed at this bridge, and he thought, wow, Dad is just so powerful. He can move this lever, and the gears would turn and this big old train bridge could go up and go down. And so it got to be lunchtime, and they went off, and he made sure the bridge was up and for the boats to go under. And and they went and went off into a field and sat down and had lunch. And as they ate, John was telling his son vivid detailed stories of where these boats were going and what these barges were carrying. And just his son was just eating it up. And then suddenly, in the middle of telling a tale, he heard a shrieking whistle of a distant train. And he looked at his watch, and he couldn't believe how much time had gone by. It was 1:07, and he remembered that bridge was raised, and the Memphis Express was going to be going by in just a few minutes. And so he calmly but firmly told his son, "Stay put." And he took off running to the controls. So he got into the control house, and he searched the river, made sure there was no boats or barges. And he was just looking around, making sure everything was clear, and he saw something caught his eye. Something was moving, and to his horror, his son had fallen down into the gears because he wanted to take off after Dad, and he fell down, and there was his son, and he could see that his son was caught, and his leg was bleeding. And then another horrifying thought flashed through his mind. Lowering that bridge would mean killing the apple of his eye, his son. And so he began to panic in his mind. He began to think of solutions, what I could do. And he's imagined I could run over there and go down on a rope, and I could pull him up, and then I could run back to the control house. But he knew that he would not, that was just all imagination. There's no way he'd be able to get back into the control tower and move that lever. And his agonized mind considered the 400 people that were moving closer and closer to their death if he didn't lower that bridge. But he knew in a moment there was only one thing he could do. He knew that he was going to have to lower that bridge. And as that train came speeding by, he put his head down and in his arm and pulled that lever. And he could hear his son, but soon that roar of that train going by with 400 people drowned out his son's cry. And John lifted his stained face up as the train was going by, and he could see the conductor nonchalantly looking at his watch. He saw a boy that looked just like his son. He saw various people sitting there having no idea what just took place to save their lives. No one even looked his way, not even a glance. And in anguish, he pounded on the glass. He said, "Don't you know, don't you care? I've sacrificed my son for you. Don't you even care?" And no one heard, no one answered. And that train disappeared out of sight. If I could have the musicians come at this time. God willingly gave his son. God knew what he was doing when he sent Jesus. And Jesus knew exactly what was going to happen when he came to this earth. But how many people, just like the people on the train, they're just going about their day-to-day business, going about their interest, not even thinking, not even caring, or not even knowing what God did to save their lives. Folks, I don't know about you, the older I get, time goes by faster and faster, doesn't it? I can't believe we're at Christmas again. It seemed like we just had Christmas. Seemed like Javi was just ripping up his Christmas present. It goes by so fast. Folks, everyone on this planet is heading towards eternity. But God lowered the bridge for each of us to get across at the expense of his son. You know, like any gift, Jesus must be received. He gave the priceless gift of heaven for each and every one of us, but he must be received. The Bible says this in John 1:11. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. God gave his gift, but the people of the time, they didn't receive him. But the Bible says, yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Have you received God's gift? Have you received God's gift? You watching online, have you received God's gift? God would not have spent that much money on his Christmas gift for you if it wasn't a necessity. If there was some other way besides the bloody death of his son, he would have done it. But it had to be Jesus. It had to be Jesus dying in our place for our sins. Our sins separate us from God, but the gift of God reconciles us back to God. It's only through Jesus. It's only through Jesus. With every head bowed, every eye closed, no one talking, no one looking around. Have you received God's Christmas gift for you? Have you received it? You're headed for eternity. Each and every one of us is going to die. We're all going to die on this earth. But only God's gift is that drawbridge that's going to get you safely to the other side, to heaven. If you haven't received Jesus, God's gift for you, you can receive him this morning. You can receive him. You say, well, how do I do that, Pastor? You just ask for it. You say, God, thank you for the gift of your son. I'm not going to ignore your gift any longer. I'm going to gratefully receive Jesus this morning. I'm going to receive him right now. Because Father, I need Jesus. I need your righteousness, your gift of righteousness. I need your gift of eternal life. I need your gift of salvation from my sins. And if that's you this morning, you want to receive God's gift just as a sign, just lift your hand, say, God, that's me. Lift your hand in the air and just say, God, that's me. I need your gift. I'm going to receive your gift. Or maybe you're here and at one time you picked up God's gift and you kind of laid it down somewhere. You kind of just forgot about God's gift. And God is tugging on your heart again and he's saying, I'm offering my gift to you again. Will you receive the gift of my son? And if you receive Jesus this morning, God will forgive you of all your sins, whatever they might be, no matter how horrendous. He'll forgive you. He'll give you righteousness. It's the righteousness of Jesus. He'll give you eternal life. He'll save you from sin and hell and an eternity of damnation. So if you need Jesus, whether you're here or watching online, raise your hand to the Lord. Say, God, that's me. I'm going to receive your gift this morning. I know God wanted me to preach this word. He wanted me to preach this word this morning. Praise you, Lord. Well, I'm going to pray. And those online, you may have raised your hand. And you mean this from your heart. Heavenly Father, thank you for all the gifts that you have given to me. God, gifts I've never even noticed. But God, I thank you for that. And I thank you, Heavenly Father, for the priceless gift of your Son, Jesus. Father, I come to you humbly. I am a sinner. I know that if I were to go into eternity, I would be going off a bridge into the abyss. I would be lost forever. But Father, this morning I receive the Christmas gift of your Son, Jesus. I need you, Jesus. I need you in my life. And I receive you this morning. And your word says that all who received you, you gave the right to become children of God. Jesus, cleanse me of my sin. Give me your righteousness. Lord, deliver me from the grasp of sin and give me salvation. Lord, I receive you this morning and give me grace, Lord, to hold on to you, the gift of life, and to live for you the rest of my life. Thank you for hearing my prayer. Thank you, Father, for the gift of Jesus. And God, I pray for those who have prayed that prayer. God, I pray that you would touch them right now, Lord. God, it's by faith that we receive your gift. But Lord, I pray your presence, your touch, your grace upon them now, Lord, that you would reassure them. For your word says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. God, that you have given Jesus, that whoever shall believe in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. God, thank you for the gift of life. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And if you prayed that prayer and you need to get plugged into church, you need to read the Bible, you need to talk to God every day. That's how you have a relationship with him. Praise the Lord. And you know, maybe you're here this morning and you've kind of been taking the gifts of God for granted in your life. Well, God loves you and he's given you gifts. Your gifts aren't the same as other people's gifts, but he's given you gifts. And I want to pray that the Lord will help you to see those gifts and to appreciate them. Lord, God, I pray, Lord, I know this is kind of like a Thanksgiving message. Lord, I pray that you would help each and every one of us to see what you have given us in our lives. Lord, that we'd be a grateful people. God, that when we walk out this door, Lord, we'll look around this wonderful world you created. God, when we go home to family and even see our pets, then we'll say, wow, Lord, what a wonderful gift. God, when we eat lunch and dinner today, we'll say, wow, Lord, thank you. Thank you for the gift of all these wonderful food flavors that can be mixed together and I can enjoy. God, I pray that you would help each and every one of us, Lord, to see the personal gifts you have given us. Lord, because you love us, because you want us to enjoy them, and Lord, we'd use them for your glory. Father God, thank you for you so loved the world that you gave your one and only Son. Thank you, Father. And Lord, I pray today, God, this Christmas season, that Jesus would be glorified. God, I pray that, Lord, that you would shine through us and help us to tell others about the greatest gift ever given, your priceless Son, Heavenly Father, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you. And are you saved this morning? Did you receive the gift of life? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Well, go with joy. And have a great afternoon, and we'll see you this evening. Lord bless you.